than it is here.
Right.
Because they're so bored, and there's a lot of, they adopt very quickly because they don't have a lot of other options.
Right.
And the government is, from President Xi down, is saying virtual reality, augmented reality, and AI.
Right.
So
right.
It's
right.
A mandate, but LBEs right. Is where everybody is.
Well, and then I have one more thing, which is I've made this thing I call a rubber. It's a facial prophylactic, and I think that's
yes.
For safety and health. And I just don't want to touch other people's face juice if I don't know you. That's me. Yeah, it's also doubles as a Halloween costume if you want to be a superhero.
By the way, anybody here see the movie Mystery Men? Very important movie because they showed the C-level superheroes, the guy that could throw a bowling ball at 10,000 yards or disappear, but only for 3 seconds. I believe we're all superheroes, but society doesn't tell us that. And I think that's part of the job of all these technologies is to provide all the mental health support and literacy that we don't get, in at least in American K-12, but I think it's global. Anyway, speaking of global, Tom, because you work all over the world, Tom and I have been buddies for a long time. And Tom is one of these guys that's so humble, he's so unlikely to promote himself, that he gets so much work because he doesn't threaten anybody. And all of a sudden he's got himself in what would be called the catbird's seat, where he's involved in some of the most amazing projects out there, but behind the scenes. And he has no issue with other people taking the credit, and he's doing well. It's all relevant.
Well, we get credits now.
Exactly.
Get credits.
Oh, you do get credits.
Yeah, we get credits.
So there you go. So why don't you introduce yourself?
My name is Tom Olson. I have a company called 3D Paint and Effects. And the company's gone through many iterations. Started out as an animation company, did some stuff for Fox Kids. And then about 6 or 7 years ago, I got into 2D, 3D conversion. And we partnered up with a company in Korea that was the best stereo conversion artists in the world. These guys are fantastic, and they still are. I'll put them up against anybody. And we got involved with Fox Home Video, and we developed an amazing pipeline for converting their entire library to stereo. And then no market materialized. So we were stuck with this really efficient pipeline and a bunch of great artists. And about 2.5 years ago, we got called into a meeting with Sam Storr over at the time of Verse. Now they're within, well, Here Be Dragons, and Within, they're kind of separated out. And they specialize in shooting in stereo VR because they feel like the stereo experience is much more powerful than a mono experience, and I have to agree with them. And the first piece I saw over there, which a lot of people know, is Clouds Over Sidra. And it's the first time I saw a VR piece. I put on the headset, and you're standing in the middle of a refugee camp in Jordan, a Syrian refugee camp, and you go, oh, I get it. There's an emotional, empathetic connection that VR has that I have never seen in any other medium. Not in cinema, not in television, not in even reading books. It's quite extraordinary. And a lot of the pieces we've gotten to work on are Gabo Arora, UN, a lot of his projects. We did Clouds Over Sidra, we did The Displaced for the New York Times, and it's just, people are in tears when they see these short videos. They're 5 minutes long, and it completely changes their whole perspective about the world. And so that's the exciting thing about VR and the power and potential of VR. The unexciting part is, it's hard. It's really hard to do. And we work behind the scenes, as David said. We specialized for the first 2.5 years, mostly on post-finishing. We wanted to make these things as polished, as high quality as you could, considering all the early rigs were very non-professional equipment. We're talking GoPros, we're talking
rubber bands.
Yeah, it's like, my God, this stuff we've had to stitch, you would not believe. And we, you know, we got to the point where we got pretty good at it. Now there's some new cameras coming out, some things are getting better, but the market's changed. It's changing very quickly. It's getting a little more difficult to get the financing for the live action stuff. It's kind of shifting over more of the technology-based stuff. They want to have light fields. They want to be in game engines so you can have real time walk around. that's all great. I think a lot of that's still a ways away, especially on the realistic side, if you want human realistic interaction. But there's still just so many powerful stories you can tell with VR. One piece we're involved in, an NPC was involved in it, was The Last Goodbye, which hasn't been released yet, but it was at Tribeca. And there's still one scene, that's the first VR piece where they combined live action with game engine. So it's about a gentleman who went to, who was in a concentration camp in World War II in Poland. And they go back to the concentration camp, and the video part is just his journey back there. And the game engine part is they reconstructed the rooms of the concentration camp, and you go in there and you stand in the room. You can actually walk around in the room with him there while he's explaining to you what it was actually like to be there. It's really powerful stuff. And that's the beauty of this medium. But like Brett said, if it's not used for something worthwhile, you know, we're just kind of wasting our time. But I think I might have gone off on a tangent there.
Not at all.
That's
my tangent. Next week, I'm giving a week and a half, I'm giving a speech at Awe on the ethical use of VR to about maybe 1,000 game people in VR. And I'm assuming I'm going to get a lot of dilated pupils.
Yeah.
They literally said no tomatoes or bananas.
Yeah. But we're starting to move into production and animation. We also do animation and game engine stuff, and that's fun. That becomes very interesting too, because there's a really cool piece we're in development on right now with Dragons that we've already done some tests on. It we put it in HTC Vive, and it's like you can switch camera positions, you can walk around the characters as they're performing or doing their thing, you can look around and just check in the whole environment. If they can get the realism into the game engines, that's going to be really, really, that's where it's really going to blow people's minds. But even now, with the live video stuff that we've worked on, a lot of that, it's so emotionally powerful, because psychologically your brain really fuses into that environment if it's done correctly. And it will change people. I mean, a lot of those projects that Chris Milk does change people's lives in a real substantial way. And so that's kind of the reward of all the hard work that we get to do.
You know, it's not just me as a little Lego talk about trying to move this towards social impact.
Mm-hmm.
Although I am 60 now, and I've committed not to do anything anymore that doesn't have social impact. HTC just put out $10 million for three applications that embrace the sustainable development goals. And this is happening more and more. I think the world is starting to wake up to how, I don't want to say screwed, so I'm not going to say that, but how challenged we are right now on the planet with people. We have this bifurcation between people that are fearful and grabbing resources and all the rest of us who are trying to figure out how to bring us all together. And there's nothing more powerful than the bullet than what we have right now, what we're doing. This is far more powerful than any movie. You used the word empathic a few minutes ago. There's an XPRIZE around empathic computing or empathic VR that's floating around. Are you familiar with that?
No.
Yeah.
I was explaining to me at some point, it's about 5 minutes of being in the immersive environment, that psychologically your brain fuses kind of with the environment. It takes about 5 minutes. And once you do, then you think you're in there. And a good example actually is one of the horror piece, Catatonic. First time I saw that, I'm sitting in a solid chair like this, and you're in a wheelchair being pushed through an assailant asylum by a bunch of crazy people. And they start pushing you down the stairs in the wheelchair, and you go over the threshold, and you feel it. You actually are like going like this. But I'm sitting in a solid chair. I mean, there's something going on there that's pretty powerful if you learn how to have fun with it, you know? And that's just a different experience than I've ever seen in cinema or television or any other format. And that's the beauty of VR, if hopefully we'll have an industry that will be sustained.
So when I ask you trends that you're observing, would you say that the fusing of the game engine with live action is one of the trends?
There's a lot of power in that. I mean, The Last Goodbye is the first one, I think, that where that's been done.
Which one?
The Last Goodbye. Yeah, I think so. I think it's still a little ways off just because of, you know, technology takes a while, much longer to advance than our dreams. you know, there's a lot of talk about light field technology and stuff like that, but, you know, the data sets are unmanageable and, you know, it's not really practical. And there's no way you can get it to play on your phone, you know. I mean, we're just having trouble playing stereo 4K on your phone, you know, let alone 8K at 120 frames a second or 90 frames a second and stuff like that.
I love the idea of an empathic computing XPRIZE, mm-hmm. because what it's identifying is that people are not being empathic with each other. It's just the opposite. Mm-hmm. They're becoming more and more alienated. And
well, that's kind of a bizarre thing about VR, though. I mean, you're actually, I was in one place where they had people speaking, and they were talking about the social media aspects of VR. I'm like, wait a minute, you're putting on a isolation device to be more social? I mean, it doesn't really make a lot of sense. So that's kind of the problem with VR. Unless everybody's wearing the headset, it's hard to have a shared social experience that you can with a movie.
Do you have any other trends you want to, anything else you've observed, besides the fact that business is a little tougher these days?
Well, the unfortunate thing is there's a lot of investment going into technology, but nobody's investing in content.
Mm-hmm. Now, when you say technology, what do you mean? Platforms, tools?
Whatever somebody wants to sell, not, you know, tracking technology, you know, display technology, any technology to make the hardware, that's where all the money's going, platforms and things like that. Unfortunately, very little of it's going into the content.
So the investors, and I know this is a sore point for Brett, but the investors are trying to figure out how to mitigate potential losses. They want to play, but they don't see an opportunity.
Fortunately, I don't think they're wrong, because the numbers aren't there yet. I mean, unfortunately, it's down to accounting. I mean, there's not much of a market of penetration.
At the beginning of cinema, the numbers weren't there either.
Yeah.
And everyone didn't put money into all the tools without actually figuring out how to tell the story. Or how to actually, you know, get actors involved. I mean, it is a very weird cognitive dissonance that's a blind spot in the industry right now, because none of these tools or platforms or anything will mean anything. Razors don't mean anything without the razor blades. If you don't got razor blades, there's no shaving going on. So this is, we need to have something that actually creates a mass market effect for any of the tech investments to mean anything.
Yeah.
Right. Well, that's the trend I see, though, that is kind of a bridge trend, is 360 video.
Yeah.
Because I guess we need the Pokemon of, you know, of VR.
360 video is, you can display it now, you have a couple billion devices out in the world that can play a 360 video immediately. Now, it's already happening. There's a couple pieces we worked on with Dragons, was like the Fight Fire with Fire for GE, little 90-second piece about putting out flames with sound waves, and it was released on Within's platform, but it got onto IFL, you know, Ethan Love Science, the blog. First week, 1 million hits. By the end of the week, it's over 4 million hits. Just a simple little 90-second, interesting, well done, well shot, well put together little 90-second piece. On the 360 video platform, it got it. Pretty large audience. At 4 million is significant. So I think I think you can't ignore the 360 video, even though purists, VR people want to make cinema or these incredible high end experiences and stuff like that. But the reality is the audience is going to be 360 video to start.
Now, speaking of ignore.